My name is Bishop Purnell from Bet Hashem Yahweh, and I'm going to pray in a blessing upon the Valerie Persaud Show. Heavenly Father, right now, and I thank and praise you for your presence. For Father, where your presence is, there you are. Heavenly Father, where your presence is, there is peace and joy forevermore. Father, where your presence is, there your son Christ, Yahshua, is. Father, right now, we also pray for everyone in the studio and everyone, Father God, who is watching. Father, we pray for the audience. Father, we call them blessed. We call them kept. We call them understanding. And Father, we call them coming into a new place into you. And Father, right now, we loose all these blessings in Christ Yahshua. Amen. Amen.
Hi, you're watching My Mama Inside.
Everyone, we're sitting here with our residential home source guy, Mr. Nicholas Irachi. How are you, Nick?
Good, Val. How are you?
Good. You look good with your leg crossed.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to pull the leg from you. Now, what are we talking about today, Nick?
We're going to talk about fire safety and smoke detectors, different types, maybe evacuation plans for the kids, little support that people ignore from time to time.
Now, why are they important?
Oh, you know, I'll go back to a story that recently happened in my hometown. There was a woman who was 80 years old who had a disabled daughter, actually. No smoke detectors, and they both perished in the fires. Really sad story. Mm. So situations like that you want to avoid.
Yeah, you know, it's still surprising in these days and times people don't have smoke detectors.
Yeah, there's really no reason for it. They're very cheap. It's currently code, so anytime I go in and reconstruct a house, they automatically kind of like slip it in. So they want me to make interconnected smoke detectors as part of the building permit. You know, it's almost standard now.
Now, is there a particular type of smoke detector that you should get?
Yeah, there's a whole slew of things that you want to, items that you want to look for. There's two types of smoke detectors. One's photoelectric. And I'm sure we've all walked through garage doors at one time, and that little safety light that goes across the bottom, you know, when you break that light, the door stops and it goes up. Well, it works similarly, only using smoke as a barrier for light. But there's another one that's more sensitive. It's called smoke detector. And what happens is it uses the same technology, light, but it's at a 90 degree angle. So when the smoke goes in, what it does is displace the light, and it measures that displacement. Now, that might mean nothing to anybody else, but it makes it more sensitive. So if you have a smaller fire, it's more readily reactive to that. So if you have a smoldering fire, you know, it'll sense it and set it off.
And you can buy those anywhere.
Oh yeah, sure. Oh, yeah.
Now, fire extinguishers, is there like a particular brand that you think is better?
I would recommend an ABC fire extinguisher. Now, the letters in front of a fire extinguisher determine what their use is. A is for just general combustible materials like wood, paper, stuff like that. I'm not going to bore you, but E goes down to, C is the electrical end of it. So, and different extinguishers contain different things. They have foam, dry chemicals, and whatnot. So what happens is if you have a fire, you need a certain chemical to douse the fire. So an ABC handles most of the common problems that you'd have. You know, electrical, combustibles, and chemical.
Wow. So when you go to build a building or do some sort of, you know, construction, you have to make sure that they have smoke detectors and fire extinguishers.
Yeah. They want them inside every bedroom as well as outside, because if you have the door closed, you know, obviously the detector's not, you know, going to operate. One in every floor. You want a carbon monoxide detector, which is really critical, because the carbon monoxide detector actually works on a completely different it responds to a completely different set of protocols or whatever. It essentially registers unused combustible fossil fuels. Mm. So if you have a water heater or a furnace or something that is using oil or natural gas or propane, what it does is, if you have any blockages in the flu, it registers it, and it's extremely important because its nickname is the silent killer. You can't smell it, you can't, you don't know if you're walking through it. And ironically, some of the symptoms are flu-like, so people think that they're sick and don't even realize it. You know, if you picture this, you're in a house and you don't have a detector and you have flu-like symptoms, you leave the house and a couple of days later, you realize that, hey, my flu went away, and then you go back into the house and all of a sudden the flu symptoms start again. So that's an indicator, one of the indicators that you might have a problem with your flu, and it's really critical.
Sounds like a lot of great information, and we're going to have Nick put some more information up on our website to kind of, conclude everything that he has said and also add some other stuff, because I'm sure there's a lot more that we can get out on the website for you guys out there. So if you want to learn more about fire extinguishers and smoke detectors, go to our website to get more information and to hear from Nick or to contact Nick. That's ValeriePersaud.com. Thank you. Hi, everyone. We're sitting here with a young woman that I work with at Rutgers. We are both trainers, and she told me the story of having Lyme disease. Now, I did not know anything about Lyme disease, and I invited her to come on the show and educate us all about exactly what is Lyme disease and how you can get it. So, Tracy, introduce yourself to the audience.
So, thanks, Valerie. I'm Tracy Hands, and I am a licensed professional counselor, a psychotherapist, and yes, I got Lyme disease several years back. In 2006, I've been practicing for about 15 years. Then in 2006, I started up an agency called Therapeutic Alliance Group to help educate and counsel people on misunderstood mental health conditions, and one of which was Lyme disease. Attention deficit disorder was what we originally started with. Lyme disease is the current focus.
Now, do most people think that you get Lyme disease from a bite from a bug?
Yes, yes. That's okay. Oftentimes the case. It's transmitted, it's a bacterial infection, and it's transmitted by the bite of a tick. It can be a deer tick, also can be a dog tick, but for the most part it's transmitted by a deer tick. Mm. And, actually one bite from a deer tick can transmit a lot of almost life-altering infections. And so we have to be really careful. The size of the ticks can be really, really small, almost, the size of a poppy seed sometimes. Mm. So it's very easy to miss.
And you may not even feel it when they bite you.
Correct.
Wow.
Correct.
Now, what are some of the symptoms of having Lyme disease?
So, one thing I do want to mention is Lyme is often considered like a gateway bug, which makes it a little bit more complicated. It can activate some underlying bacterial virus infections, fungal infections in the body that ordinarily we wouldn't be affected by. Our body keeps it as an opportunistic infection. But Lyme goes in there and kind of invades the immune system, and it leaves us unable to properly fight for other things. Mm. So Lyme can look like a host of different things. One thing to talk about is the telltale bullseye rash. A lot of people talk about seeing a bullseye rash, and that some folks even say that you have to have that in order to get a diagnosis of Lyme. It's actually not true. It's actually a rare, it's the percentage is quite low of folks who have it or who notice that they have it. So that's not really a good indicator of ruling it in or ruling it out.
Wow. So once you think that you may have some symptoms of Lyme disease, you should head straight to your doctor.
You should, yes. And we'll talk a little bit in a few minutes about testing, because that's, can be problematic as well. I think one thing also to know about a sign of Lyme disease is facial asymmetry. So some people have palsy of one side of their face, and sometimes you can just see it in asymmetric smile, and that's a sign of infection, and systemic infection in the body. Chronic infection leads to chronic inflammatory response. So there are many folks who have this and don't even know it, and they start reacting to the world around them, whether it's food or just the toxins in the environment, and they're actually struggling with underlying Lyme infection.
Now, when you go to the doctor, would every doctor know the symptoms of Lyme disease?
Unfortunately not. Education needs to happen, which is one of the reasons why there's now many agencies that are putting forth efforts to educate the public, doctors, you know, et cetera. A lot of people really need to learn a lot more. On the whole, we have a lot more to learn about Lyme disease. It's very complicated.
So as a patient, you have to advocate for yourself. You have to say, I think I have Lyme disease, and then encourage the doctor to run these tests.
Yeah, and sometimes you really need to link or go to a what's called a, folks are calling it a Lyme literate practitioner, mm-hmm. and so, or Lyme literate physician. These are folks that tend to be functional doctors or integrative doctors. They're more systemic. And because Lyme can go in and invade all the different systems in the body, I mean, you can have musculoskeletal symptoms of Lyme, you can have gastrointestinal, you can have neurologic, cardiac, psychiatric symptoms. It runs the gamut. So really the doctors that best treat this are ones that take a big picture, and they're kind of jack of all trades. You know, in order to identify and to manage these symptoms, you know, Lyme causes such great disruption and dysfunction in the body, these doctors need to be systemic doctors. So typically the specialists are not the best folks to go to. You know, in my case, I went to, like in many people's case, over 60 doctors before wow. getting a diagnosis. The foot doctors, that's where it started, the dermatologists, and then the endocrinologist, and then finally to a neurologist who actually was the one that diagnosed me. Wow. Early diagnosis is one of the best things we can aim for right now, because it, you know, late diagnosis leads to treatment failures, and that's one of the biggest concerns out there. Very hard to treat.
What else did you want to get out about Lyme disease?
So I think, I mean, I mentioned it can invade any organ in the body. It can invade your nervous system. A lot of people have twitching. A lot of people have all sorts of different dysregulation. It also likes tissue better than it likes blood. So these bugs actually hide in the collagen and in the tissues of the body, which makes the tests difficult because they're given blood tests. Mm-hmm. It also disables the immune system, which further makes the tests more ineffective. So it's those Lyme literate practitioners who really know the proper tests, and really this still, unfortunately, there's not really good adequate testing. Mm-hmm. The Lyme literate practitioners know that there are pretty much a small handful of labs, like Igenex is one, and Stony Brook, and advanced labs that now are more sensitive, but still we're struggling to get a good test out there.
Wow. Now this is, you know, this, of course, needs more information, more than we have the time for. Yeah. So we want to let folks know that you can go to our website at valerieprasad.com, and we will have Tracy's link to your own website.
Sure.
Or to
what I think we're also going to put on there is the list of symptoms, which include the cognitive decline, the psychiatric symptoms. There's an article that I'm going to link on there to your site, and mm-hmm. we can mm-hmm. do it either way, mm-hmm. but that identifies a list of microbial infections that are actually linked to behavioral symptoms and mental illness. Because there's a lot. Lyme is just one of them. But Lyme is particularly insidious because it invades the soft tissue and it hides, it encapsulates. It's hard for medicine to get in there and so on. But I will have lists of not only, you know, there's plenty of support groups, there's forums out there. There's a lot of agencies, Tick-Borne Disease Association, Lyme Disease Association, who aim to educate on Lyme disease. So we'll have that information available.
Yes, now did we miss anything? We talked about the symptoms, talked about going to your doctor.
There's another complicating factor, which is co-infections that can happen when you're bitten by a tick. It's often the tick carries other infections as well, Babesia, Ehrlichia, there's a host of them. So they create so many different symptoms, night sweats, et cetera. So Lyme can masquerade as many different, as you can imagine, with all these symptoms. It can look like MS, ALS. It might even underlie these diseases. Doctors are looking into that now.
You can go to our website, and then we should have a link which will take you to Tracy's site so you can get a lot more information, because you have a lot of stuff that you want to share with folks out there. So be sure to check out one of those sites. Thank you for being here, Tracy.
Thank you, Valerie.
Love and happiness, something that can make you do wrong but make you do right. Love. Thank you.
Several of my students from Rutgers University and Monmouth University to celebrate Women's Month and Social Work Month, and I would like for them to introduce themselves to you and let you know what exactly this event means to you.
Sure. Hi, my name is Narshana Towns, and I'm a student at Drew Theological School and Monmouth University. And what this event means to me is to continue a wonderful legacy of not just women but social workers. I think of my ancestors that were a part of the NAACP, particularly my grandmother, my aunts, who have been such an influence in my life and the pursuit of my goals. And so that's what this is for me, just to pass the torch and to continue that on. So thank you for allowing me to be here.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sonia Singh. I'm actually a senior at Rutgers University studying social work. This event is very important to me because women have made great strides. Particularly in the workforce, and within this decade, women will actually outbeat men in the workforce. There'll be more women working in the workforce than men. That's wonderful, knowing that I had my ancestors, that the women in my family that couldn't even work. So that's what the importance of this.
All right, here's Marisol. How are you, Marisol?
Good, how you doing? Hi, my name is Marisol, and I graduated from Rutgers recently, and I've been accepted into Columbia University. And I am pursuing actually policy analysis, because that's what I want to do in the future, because being a woman of Latina descent, and actually being born and raised not too far from here, my mom actually welcomed all the adolescents from the area, and she taught them how to live a better life, how to get away from drugs. And I kind of pursuing that, and I'm hoping with being a policy analyst that I could help other future workers, future social workers, not just to be able to deal with the organization, but to be the power and the force behind policy, so we don't have to sit there and wait, where's the grant, where's this, where's that? No, the power is going to be in our hands.
Hi, everyone. My name is Paula Sorribio. I'm a major, triple major, actually, at Rutgers University in Newark. Social work, nursing, and psychology major. I'm very proud of being a woman, first of all. I'm a mother, I'm a social worker, and I'm going for the best and trying to empower women to do their best, because if I can do it, everybody can do it.
Hi, I'm Allison Raphael, founder and chief creative officer of Allison Raphael Cosmetics, and today I'm here at the Beauty Spa in Englewood with Bianca Steinle, the spa director. So Bianca, how many years has the Beauty Spa been here?
26.
Okay. Well, I remember it from when I was a kid, and I've always loved it. When you created the Beauty Spa, it was the first of its kind in this whole area in Bergen County outside of New York. Tell me what your original vision was for the Beauty Spa and what makes it so special.
Well, the concept was to provide clients with services, facials, massages, pedicures, manicures, hair, etc., at a level where it's almost a medical grade, yes, if you will.
Yes.
With no fluff.
Okay.
It's all, it all has a purpose and a reason to be. Our hydrotherapy has a reason to be. Our pedicures are unequaled, really.
Yes.
All of our instruments come out of an autoclave.
Yes.
Which is perfectly sterilized.
Safe, sanitary, yes.
Absolutely. And even the device where you soak your feet, mm-hmm, is lined in plastic.
Okay.
And that is thrown away after each use. So it's perfectly clean and safe,
right,
for everyone.
That's always been a big thing here, and you were doing it before anyone else. What other services? So you have hydrotherapy. You have facials, which I got one a couple weeks ago, and it was amazing. What other services do you offer here?
I mentioned manicures, pedicures. We also do hair.
Okay.
We do fantastic hair treatments, hair extensions.
Oh, okay.
Wonderful, beautiful. We have a young hairdresser that does that, a fellow. Mm-hmm. Marcelo is his name, so I'll give him a little plug.
There you go.
And we do our facials. We have two distinctive categories.
Okay.
One is the 1 hour European facial.
Okay.
And within that category, there are subdivisions depending on what needs to be done for the specific client that we're working on.
Okay.
We also do a cleansing treatment that is only half hour. This is for people on the go.
Okay, okay.
Who don't have much time really.
Okay. You also do makeup and...
We do makeup.
Brows?
Actually, we use your line.
Yes, yes.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
And one of the premises that we encounter sometimes after a facial is that clients tell us, well, I just had a facial. I really don't want to put makeup on.
Right.
This is an old belief,
right,
if you will.
Yes.
This is when pigments were really harmful.
Yes.
And... it's a very outdated belief. Today, makeup is actually protective.
Yes, it is.
And this is why we work with your line, Alison Raffaele.
Thank you. And it's a pleasure to be here. You also do brows. And let me think, what else? What else would you tell someone? If somebody was first coming here to the beauty spa, what would be the one thing you would want them to know about the beauty spa?
Try our facials.
Try our facials. All
They're
right.
Unequal.
Yes, they really are. So, what are the hours of operation? When can people come here and experience the amazing treatments?
We open at 9 o'clock every morning.
Okay.
6 days a week.
Okay.
From Monday to Saturday.
Okay.
We work. Saturday we work until 4.
Okay.
Thursday we work until 9.
Okay.
So it gives you a pretty full spectrum of timing. If you work, you know, if you're busy, if you have a complicated lifestyle,
right,
like most people have today.
Yes. And so basically it's really everything you need under one roof.
Absolutely.
Hair, makeup, you sell the skincare,
absolutely,
you sell the hair care, you
yes,
sell the
do.
Makeup. You know, do people come here, you know, generally with your clients, who is your typical client?
A working woman.
Okay.
Is our typical client.
And
who wants to maximize her timing.
Yes, that would make sense.
We do more than one thing in one visit.
Okay.
To maximize her time.
Okay.
Sometimes we do more than one thing at the same time to maximize her timing here. We realize that people today really don't have the time we had years ago. You know, it just doesn't exist today.
No, it definitely doesn't. In fact, I think with all these time-saving devices, we just get busier, not more relaxed. But this is definitely a great place to relax. Tell me a little bit about the massage treatments and the different types of massage treatments you have.
I'm glad you asked. We do massages from 1 hour massage on. That's
okay.
It. But before the massage, free of charge,
okay,
there is a body scrub.
Ooh!
Because this body scrub makes the body more receptive to the massage.
Okay.
So it's really an incredible treatment, an incredibly good treatment for the client, and it's included in the price.
Oh, okay, fantastic. You also have a treatment called Nirvana, which definitely appeals to me.
Yes, we do. That is an Ayurvedic treatment.
Okay.
Ayurveda is an ancient Indian medicine belief and protocol that is 5,000 years old.
Okay.
Everything in it is edible. All the products that we use in it are edible.
Okay.
So it's really very compatible with our own environment,
okay,
our own bodies. And they're wonderful. They're really, it's like a mini vacation.
So Bianca, so you know, we were talking about how really cosmetics are not harmful to the skin, they're helpful. One of the things obviously I know, but not everybody else does, is you have a makeup artist here, Chris, of course, who's my good friend.
Absolutely.
Now, after the facials, they can get their makeup done, right?
After the facials, we offer free of charge a light makeup application.
Right.
So you can go out to dinner, you can go out to lunch, or you can just go home looking terrific.
Right. Well, this is helpful. Yeah, especially if you're doing this on your lunch hour.
Absolutely.
You know, you don't go back naked faced.
No, you go back looking absolutely super.
That's amazing. Well, you might go back looking a little too good, and then suddenly, where have you been? You've been to the beauty spa.
Thank you guys for joining us for a great show. Remember, if you want to get in contact with us or see our old shows, go to our website, which is www.valerieprasad.com. We're also on Twitter and LinkedIn. So in parting, we always wish you love, peace, and blessings. Goodbye.